how I feel, cause I know that it's something real. Hey, hey, gonna say how I feel, cause I know that it's something real.
Gretchen, welcome to show 60. I cannot believe that I have done this for 60 nights in a row. Huh. Except for those three that I pre-recorded. Everything's been live. Oh my goodness. Pull my microphone here in front of me a little bit. That's pretty amazing. And several of you have been here so often. Gloria and Angie and Deirdre's been joining so much. It's really quite an honor. I you know, today was quite the day. Can I turn up my sound? Yes, I can. Let me see. I have the other one down. Thank you for keeping me up on that, because sometimes when I'm working throughout the day, let's see. I have it plugged into my ears. Maybe you can hear me. Let me check my output here. System preferences, sound. There. Yep. Okay. Up a little bit. And output. Should be those in output. All right. Is that better? I'm hoping it is. Yay. Good. Good, good, good. Oh, all right. That can go fiddly-dee. Well, so it was one of those days where I got up this morning with full intentions of coming downstairs really quick and doing a quick little thumbnail for tonight's show. And because I didn't do it last night, because quite frankly, we had taped RuPaul and I wanted to watch RuPaul's drag show. And so I'd been getting up really early on Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday for that conference that I was at. So I was kind of done with getting up early. So I slept in this morning, and then I got up and boom, there was somebody's premiere was right off the, NK premiere. And then it just started rolling. Did I get my thumbnail done? If you noticed, the whole thing didn't post until just after 5. Oh my gosh. Because I got, if I do it right after the show, then I give myself a really limited what time. Can you hear me now, Gloria? So can you hear? Give me thumbs. Yes, thumbs. I'm up. I'm not muted. It says I'm playing through. Okay. So it is one of those things that if I give myself just a little bit of time right after the show, I do a thumbnail and I just get it done and it's good. Hi, Janice. Good. Yay. Nice to have you here. So I didn't do that last night. So it, rather than give myself this limited amount of time, unfortunately I had a lot of time, which is not good for someone who wanted, I got an idea in my head on which book and all this kind of things. And oh my gosh, the whole opening section turned into a kind of a crazy bit of finding my photographs and removing backgrounds and putting them in weird places and finding, you know, oh geez, if I just would have done it, I would have been fine. But no. Hey, Sammy, nice to have you here. So anyway, the opening sequence there was a whole compilation video of a bunch of my photographs overlaid on top of one larger photograph and then overlaid on top of a video. I did all that in Canva, which was really a lot of fun, but digging through things and then deciding I had to edit the photos before I did. Oh my gosh. Never, never let a photographer. Yeah. Just too crazy, too crazy. I just should have done it late last night and been done with it, but that's okay. Anyway, the book I chose for tonight is one by a woman named Barbara Helen Berger. And Barbara is from the Northwest. She used to live on Bainbridge Island, which is just a ferry ride. Well, actually, I could drive to it if I went around through one way. There's one way. Or I could take a ferry to it. And it's a very popular place to live right now. It's become kind of the place that people who worked in down in Seattle but didn't want to live in Seattle and could afford it got on Bainbridge because then they could ride the hour ferry commute. But it's a beautiful, beautiful island and has been for years and years and years. Barbara had lived out there for, I've known her for a good 35 years maybe. She is the author of one of the very first books I ever got signed. She is the author of some books called, one of them's called Grandfather Twilight, and I have a miniature of it that I had for my daughter. Another one's called When the Sun Rose. Then she has a book called Gwenna, which is a longer novel type book about a girl that grows owl wings. And it's a beautiful, beautifully written fantasy book. But Animalia, she came out with this book. Let me show you a little bit about her first here. Let me see. Let's get this up. Three. There. Okay. So this is on her website. And as she says painting's her foundation. For a decade or more, she worked in acrylic on canvas, layers shifting to paper, then painted the illustrations for her children's books. But she's also had harbored a long fascination for collage and assemblage. She's been exploring those in the last. And writing, the word essay used to turn her way with a shudder. It sounded cold and impersonal. It was too rational, I thought, about some nonfiction, but long ago what changed? She learned that essays could be personal, even intimate. And an essay can be warm, it can be lyrical. And in children's books, she first began to write and illustrate children's books. She had no idea what a pleasure or how much work. A picture book is a skinny sort of book, but a whole world can open up in those few pages. Art and words unite, telling the story for eyes and ears once more. This is a piece of her artwork. I'll see if it has any other art pieces here that she has. Yes, she has a series in assemblage, a series in collage, and What Shakes the Eye is an artist's book, which is looks like really cool. I haven't seen that one. It's been years since I've seen her or what she's done, but she shows how the book opens. Oh my gosh, you guys, look at that. Oh, wow. Okay, we have to investigate that again. But her children's books, pull them up. Okay, so Grandfather Twilight is the one that I have two copies of. I have the miniature copy and then I have a larger copy. It is was in 1984, so that was the year Annalena was born, and I know I got that for her then. Donkey's Dream is the story of the birth of Christ through the eyes of the donkey. And he walks along as a donkey dreams. He's carrying a city, a ship, a fountain, a rose, then a lady full of heaven. It is such a beautiful book. A lot of otters I don't have. All the way to Lhasa, A Tale from Tibet. I've heard of that. Now, Animalia is the one that we'll be reading tonight. She learning to do calligraphy, she says she fell in love with medieval illuminated manuscripts. I wanted to try and make one for children of our own time. I was also exploring Buddhism and Christianity and found a great compassionate heart in both. In Buddhism, the big heart includes not only human beings, but all beings, even small insects. Gwenna, this is the one, is a story of a girl who has wings but does not know it. Yeah, it's an amazing book. The Jewel Heart I used to have, but I think one of my kids has that now. Angels on a Pin was a favorite one in the library. It's about a whole world on the top of a pin, a sewing pin. And this one, When the Sun Rose. A magic friend comes with her lion from a yellow rose of the rising sun, and she stays to play. The lion purred, and we made rainbows all day. At sunset, the friend must leave, but she promises to return because now it's dark and my friend is gone. It's a beautiful, beautiful book. I used to read it to the kids. Thunder Bunny, Where to Find Your Books. So tonight we're going to read Animalia, which is a beautiful collection. Let me just lean over here and turn off my heat. Woo! Yeah, don't need heat on in here. Let's see. Let's check. Donna's here. Hi, Donna. Oh, great. Gloria and Donna and Deidre. Sammy's here. Yay. Joanne's here. Nope, you didn't miss the story yet, Joanne. You're not late. I'm doing a precursor about Barbara. She's like really one of the first author illustrators that I collected here in the Northwest years ago. I know, like I said, Grandfather's Story came out in 1984, which was the year that my daughter, oldest daughter, was born. And I know I got that book for Annalena right away. I had the larger book was for Annalena. The miniature book is for Bryn. When the Sun Rose, I can't remember when this one came out, but I've had that one. That's always been a favorite one. I used to read to the girls all the time. But it's funny that Animalia is published, and there's another book called Animalia by Graham Bays that's an alphabet book that's very popular, and it's beautiful, but it's not anywhere near the same kind of story. Like she said, she got the idea of this from manuscripts. Let's see. And if I can remember, we're going to go to the book now. Oh, I had something happen. There we go. What happened? There we go. There it is. So this is the book, Animalia. And it is, she says, so you can see the art. Let me read you what she says about the art, what she did. She says, these stories were found in books about the saints, books of Chinese tales, and the story of Buddha's life. Some have been retold with little change. Others have been freely embellished and adapted in the retelling. In the days before the printing press, books were handwritten and often illuminated with painting. The paintings in Animalia were done in acrylic on fine watercolor paper. The calligraphy was done separately in ink. Both were then reduced. My warmest appreciation goes to all at Celestial Arts, especially Orly Kelly, editor of children's books, and Abigail Johnston, art director. So in 1982, that's when she wrote this. So this book, as we hear it and understand, let me set it so you can see the picture just a little better on this. I'm going to zoom it in for you so you can get it a little bit closer. So you, as artists, you're going to absolutely love this. Not only did she illustrate the pictures and write the story or retell the story, but she actually did the calligraphy for the book too, in writing it out. So Animalia, 13 small tales, retold, handwritten, and illuminated by Barbara Berger, handwritten. Breath, life, and soul were known as anima in Latin. Our word animal comes from this. There are always people who live in harmony with Animalia, kingdom of animals. Many have been saints and sages who live in legends still. Each of these 13 small tales is a bit of their old lore retold. The first called Duet. Rose was in the garden when she heard the nightingale. She echoed with song of her own. The bird sang again, and Rose sang too, in her turn. Thus they passed the hour, singing an antiphonal duet. Rose let the nightingale sing the last soaring notes. Then the bird flew to her open hand. Rose said softly, "Your song has no compare. Are you an angel in those plain feathers?" The nightingale shook himself, then vanished. Only silent light was left for Rose to hold. These stories are all going to be very short like that. Let me give you just a little. There. So you can see all the way to the edge of her pictures. Just absolutely beautiful illustrations and the details. Little Brothers. I love how she took the tales and the stories and legends from all over time and different religions and places to come together with this. And if you've been on this at all with me, you know that I have a special affinity for animals, and listening to them, it's always been an important thing. Saint Francis walked from place to place with care. Often he saw a small creature on the road, a beetle, an earthworm, a spider or a snail, a centipede, or a lazy toad. He would bend down and gently lift the little being to the roadside, far away from the horse's hoof and wagon wheel. There he would let it go. "Peace be with you, little brother," he would say. All these details. Dragon's Eye, one of my favorites, of course. I like the quail that she does here. Petra lived in a cave with no one near but the wild animals. Any of them who came to her in need found care, for the art of healing was in her hands. She bound broken legs and wings and tended many ills. The animals had only trust to give her in return, and Petra never wished for more. One day, a young dragon came to her cave,
moaning abysmally. While other creatures fled, Petra sought the source of pain. In one death stroke, she pulled a thorn from the dragon's eye. Sighing in gratitude, the dragon lowered his head to the ground. A fiery jewel rolled from his tongue at Petra's feet. And ever after, she was glad for the warmth it gave. Oops, I forgot to put my phone on Do Not Disturb. There we go. Plugged it in, but I didn't put it on Do Not Disturb. I love this dragon. It just is so, and then these little animals here that she's taking care of. A choir. Brother Benno was walking along, chanting his prayers. He came to a marsh where the frogs were chanting too. Their sound was so great that Brother Benno could not hear himself. He said in a loud voice, "Be still!" And they were. In the stillness, Brother Benno began to feel very small. He thought, "God might enjoy the chanting of these frogs more than my prayers." So he said to the frogs, "I am sorry for being so rude. Please go on singing as you wish." And one by one, the frogs began to croak. Soon they were a choir of sound again, and Brother Benno listened. The fly. Oh my gosh. I heard a sound behind me, Chris. Sorry. And it's Stella, my daughter's dog that we're keeping. And she's like, she can hardly see. She can't hear. She's old. And she's just sneaking around behind me. Stella, good girl. Okay, this is called The Fly. The son of a king came to a cottage where a maiden welcomed him. She brought a steaming pot and poured a cup of tea. Just as the king's son was about to drink, a fly fell into his cup. The maiden gasped and rushed all a flutter to seize the cup from his hand. She scooped the fly out on her fingertip. Then she blew long and gently on the fly's wings and countless fine hairs. Soon the fly was grooming himself with his legs, so the maiden nudged him onto a windowsill. Only then did she return to her royal guest to pour him a fresh cup of tea. Happy Goldfish. I love this one because it reminds me of my koi photographs that I have. It just, and the illustrations, all the details within this. I don't know if you guys can see some of these, how much detail there is in all of that. And like in the fly's wings and all the birds and everything, even down to the wrinkles in the socks. Oh, Stella! Yes, Stella. Oh, now she's over on the couch. There's a little, like a little love seat couch over there. She is not allowed on the one upstairs, so she comes and gets on this one. That's okay. She's a good dog. A sage and his friend were walking by a pool. The water was cool and green and deep, and in its shade, the goldfish shone like fragments of the sun. The sage watched them for a long time. At last he smiled and said, "They are happy." "You are not a goldfish," said his friend. "How do you know they are happy?" The sage said, "You are not I. So how do you know?" that I do not know they are happy. Sister Hare, this owl, she has an owl similar to this in Gwynna, the book. Oringa was lost in the forest one night. Fear gathered the shadows around her heart, but all she could do was sit down among roots to wait the darkness through. A hare came toward her, tall ears turning to every sound. But hares live in the open, not in a forest. Oringa whispered, "Sister Hare, are you lost too?" Calm as the moon, the hare came and settled in Oringa's lap. And the long night passed in the comfort of her company. At dawn, Oringa followed the hare. She led between shadows and over roots into the open and home again. Dream. Oh, I'm sure that the way you guys listen, when one of these stories will speak to you in a different way, just like when I do the readings from my book on the quotes always tend to be, but there's always sometimes out of these kind of stories, one that really speaks to people in different ways. So Angie's on her way. Oh, Joanne, you've collected frogs since fifth grade. They are all over my house, and I have two frog tattoos. Joanne, have you ever seen a frog, what is it called, a frog bloom? I was at a lake this past summer near Mount St. Helens. My son-in-law was running a 73-mile race there. And so we went and we were camping at this lake, and I had the grandkids, and we went down and we couldn't figure out why the shores of the lake were like black. And then all of a sudden it was like they were moving and there was a frog bloom. I have pictures. I'll have to bring them up at some point. And I have pictures of my grandkids, Rook and McLean, literally with their hands covered with tadpoles. I mean, you could scoop them out. You couldn't walk across the lawn to the lake without stepping on them. You had to be really careful. So you just kind of stood there, and they scooted all around. There were literally hundreds. I mean, there were probably millions of these frogs. And it covered the whole north end of the, or east side of this one part of this lake. It was amazing. I've been around frogs and stuff like that, but I'd never experienced a frog bloom like that. It's crazy. Oh my goodness. Oh, Angie, don't be upset. You're here. We're only halfway through the stories. There's 13 stories tonight in this book called Animalia. And a lot of the, oh, I love the way that here on the front cover, how she combined so many different things. Like I said, it's pretty stunning to imagine that she not only illustrated these, rewrote or retold the story in her own words, but she also did the handwritten calligraphy for the original and the book, and then that was rendered and reduced to be these. I've seen some of her original pieces when she does these, and they're good size. This was probably done like this is a 9 by 12 book. So this picture is probably 7 by 10. Or an 8 by 10, probably a 7 by 10 or 8 by 10 on a piece of paper because it goes over. But the original is probably a 16 by 20, knowing the way that she works. Anyway, this is called The Dream, I believe, isn't it? Yes, The Dream. Once upon a time, a philosopher fell asleep. He dreamed he was a butterfly. From flower to flower, he fluttered in the bright air. Resting at the center of each one, he unwound his spiral tongue to taste the nectar there. Then the philosopher awoke. He asked himself, "Was I a human being asleep who dreamed he was a butterfly? Or am I now the butterfly asleep who dreams he is being human?" Sea friend. This one, I love this. And look at all the different, maybe there's a periwinkle in here. Oh my gosh. If you had to be on Massey Boys this morning to know the periwinkle joke, it was hilarious. There was a monk who lived by the sea, where the breath of distant whales sounded near. He would stand in reverence all night in the waves, and otters came to play at his feet. By day, he went out in a little boat. If a whale came close, he calmly thought, "We are made by the same hand, you and I." Once, he dropped his book overboard. As it sank, his heart sank with it, for in those days, every word was handwritten. A book was a treasure indeed. Before long, an otter brought the book alongside. The monk reached down and found his treasure dry. Not a single word was washed away. Then the otter was gone, leaving only a ripple upon the waves. Doves. I love how she does the intro in black and white in this monotone. In China, there was a prince who showed his kindness by setting doves free. Once a year, the air was filled with beating wings, but a tear shone on the cheek of his bride, and the prince asked her why. "Dearest," she said, "the doves are freed because they are caught, and they are caught for you to set them free. But in the nets, wings and necks are broken. Many doves die." So the prince ruled that doves were never more to be captured in his land. Every year, they came freely, in a splendor of beating wings, to coo in peace upon the palace roof. The stag. If you look, I gotta lift this up so you can see. See this? There we go. Look at the eye inside that. I showed you her work that she's working on, the artist's eye, and the eye unfolds. That's very similar. I wonder, that's cool. Deep in the forest, Saint Godric lived alone, his hut hidden in briars. One day he heard a horn and the baying of hounds on the hunt. Suddenly a stag bounded to him, magnificent and trembling. Godric led the stag into his hut. Then he came out, shut the door, and sat down. Soon a frenzy of hounds surrounded him, but Godric was still. The dogs could not get by him. When the hunters came, they asked, "Where is the stag?" Slowly, Godric opened his eyes. "God knows where he may be," he said. "This is a holy man," the hunters thought, and a holy man does not lie. So they gathered their hounds and left. When the forest was safe again, Godric opened his door, and the stag was free. Swan. Prince Siddhartha saw the wild swans one day flying white as clouds over the palace. His cousin took a bow, drew back the string, and let an arrow fly. One swan fell. Both boys ran, and the prince came first to the place where the swan lay. She was still alive. He took her in his arms and pulled the arrow from her. "Give the swan to me," his cousin said. "She is mine, for my arrow brought her down." Siddhartha gave the arrow back and said, "Let us seek the counsel of the wise." The palace wise men weighed the question carefully. Then the oldest of them spoke, "A life does not belong to the one who brings it harm," he said. And all agreed. So the swan remained in Prince Siddhartha's care. And when her wound was healed, he rejoiced to see her fly again. Love that one. The turtle. I think, oops, is that one? This might be the last one. The last one. The turtle. Long ago, a sage came to a great river. There was no bridge and no boat to carry him across, so he walked along the shore. Soon he found a large turtle in a trap. The turtle's shell rose like a dome of jade. The sage knew this was a being far more ancient than himself. He set the turtle free. At the water's edge, the turtle waited, looking back at him with a timeless eye. The sage understood. He stepped up on the turtle shell. The turtle swam out onto the river, bearing the old man in steady grandeur to the other shore. Look at the swallow that she did up there. Isn't that just beautiful? And the fish, can you see the fish? And there's a little snail at the end here. I love this. And the butterfly here. So yeah, she did these all in acrylic. We're done in acrylic on fine watercolor paper. And the calligraphy was done separately in ink. So she would have done the layout for the calligraphy of a size related to it. And then she would have done this very similar to the way the medieval books are done, with this kind of lettering to start each type of things. The old, they would have that. I wonder, there's a book. How many of you have ever seen The Neverending Story? Of course. Well, that started out, it's a book. And the original book, each chapter, and it's originally in German, I believe, but each chapter starts with the next letter in the alphabet. So first chapter starts with A, the second chapter starts with B. Anyway, it's one of my very favorite books. Also beautifully taking from that medieval type of aspect. But that's an Amelia and her little otter. That otter has shown up in other things that I've seen her do. But yeah, let's see if I can find, those were her books. Let's go back to, art. And so this, I was showing what shakes the eye, but this is her, a series in assemblage, holding peace. Let's see if it'll come up. So it's a, holding peace is an ongoing series. It began with the grief I felt in my belly during the time of war. Each piece includes a ball I've painted to evoke our world. Each one is held in a different way. More than ever in our time of global suffering and peril, I need the healing alchemy of art to help me carry my share of awareness, to transform the grief and not succumb to despair. The art of assemblage has become to me a poetry of objects. It has given my hands a way of making tangible prayers. Tapped out. Angie, that's funny. Angie says, no, I was making an ugly painting. No, you know what? It's all, it was for a reason. You needed to get that through. You're okay. I know. Aren't her illustrations gorgeous? And the work, like this piece, this whole set that she's done, the art of assemblage, her website is bhberger.com. bhberger.com. And the work that she's done is just amazing. Let's see what shakes the eye. Let's see what else we can have. Permissions is a series in collage. And after painting in fine detail for so many years, I wanted to do something different. My weary hand needed a new way of working, so I went to a lively workshop in collage. If I remember years ago, when I was talking with her one time at a book signing at Secret Garden, she was having issues with arthritis in her hand and was concerned about what it was going to do to her. So, collage. The workshop leader was showing us a new and liberating technique that he had developed. Everyone around me was taking the leap. They were all busy making wonderful things, but I felt stuck. Ah, have we all been there? I needed permission. Who was withholding it from me? Certainly not the workshop leader or anyone else. No one but myself. In the collage materials I'd brought from home were some old sealing wax seals. They looked official, so I decided to make myself a certificate of permission and to make it using the very method we were learning. One certificate led to another and then another. After the workshop, one by one, they slowly became a series. I needed so much permission. A couple of years later, the whole series went on view at the Gallery of Bainbridge Arts and Crafts. That was in 2007. We called the show Permissions. Each collage was framed to float in a shadow box, and by the end of the show, all but three were sold. During the exhibition, I learned how many people share the same feeling, how we all seem to need permission in various ways, and how we can grant it to each other and to ourselves. Oh my gosh. She says, like this is allow. Oh my gosh, look at this, you guys. Look at that. Okay. And this one. Wow. Okay, so they, her collage. So she said, down here, she says, see Collage, A New Approach by Jonathan Talbot for the technique I learned in his inspiring workshop. Here it is. Talbot1.com. Studio of Jonathan Talbot, painter, printmaker, and collage artist. Oh my goodness. Yeah, he's got a little bit of been showing around. Wow, works and books. Anyway, it would be fun to look that up. Collages. I have a my best friend that lives on Whidbey Island has been doing a lot of collage, and she ends up being the assistant in a lot of the art workshops that are up there so that she can get in on those. She's just really efficient. She's who inspired me to become a librarian. She was the original book lady, and I was a book lady. But not now. Anyway, so, hey, how are you, Nathan? So glad you're here. I don't know when you got in. I was reading. So I hope everybody enjoyed these and can see the work and are inspired by Barbara's work. She has done so many different things. You know, not only the children's books, like I said, all of these books that she's done are so beautiful, and she's written and illustrated them all. And I love this one. I wish I had The Way to Lhasa. Gwenna, I have. It's sitting right in there. I have Donkey's Dream. I think it's at my granddaughter's grandfather Twilight. I think I have Bryn's Little One. I don't have Jewel Heart. I gave that to one of the girls. Thunder Bunny, I never had. That's something. But When the Sun Rose, I am sure that is at Bryn's house. It's a pretty amazing book. A lot of otters. So, yeah, she says that. She said here it is a little bit more about writing children's books, and I've talked about the art of children's literature, and it's that a lot of people think it's an easy thing to write a children's book sometimes. When I first began to write and illustrate children's books, I had no idea what a pleasure or how much work it would be. A picture book is a skinny sort of book, typically 32 pages in all. But a whole world can open up in those few pages. Art and words unite, telling a story for eyes and ears at once. A picture book is an intimate thing, often shared across the lap at bedtime. How many writers and artists can imagine their work entering people's lives in such a cozy way? For me, it's been a privilege and a joy. Most of my 10 titles are meant for the very young, but they are also meant for the ages from toddlers on up, including adults. I've written one longer book for older children, Gwenna, an illustrated fairy tale in chapters. It too can be read aloud as well as quietly alone. You can find out more about each book by clicking on the book covers. So this one is one of my very, oh, I love this one. Come on. This is Her Lion Came In With Her. It's one of my favorite illustrations. It just glows off the page. And the yellow roses that the girl wears are just amazing. Yeah, got all kinds of awards. And she dedicated it to Sherry, who she met in first grade. We were best friends all through school and are still closest friends to this day. I love it. But that's, let's see. But so that's the stories for tonight. Animalia is the book that I had. Like I said, it says breath, life, and soul were known as anima in Latin. I don't know if I pronounced that right. Our word animal comes from this. Legends tell of wise and holy people who lived gently with Animalia, kingdom of animals. I think we can all learn something from that. I love the stories. I hope you did too. It's been a delight to share it, and I can't believe that I've had 60 60 of these. Whew, whoa. So, you know, if you like it, like, don't forget to boom, whatever that button thing is. Maybe share this out with somebody who you know might like books and who might maybe not have access to some and who might want to have something that they could let their little ones listen to or would want to listen to themselves. But I so appreciate you joining me on this journey. And it's just a delight. Nathan's been here, Donna, Angie, Gloria, Deirdre's here. Saw some, Janice was here. You love the never, he loves the never ending story. You luck dragon. Yeah, you have your own luck dragon. I have my own luck dragon. I call him Ancient. Yep. But it's, yes, it's one of those movies that I've sat down with my granddaughter, and the way it starts is kind of like, she doesn't quite get it. But then once you get into it, oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. Hi, Joanne's here. Oh, you saw a baby otter on Animal Planet yesterday. That was one of the highlights of this year for me when I went in June to Monterey to photograph, and I got to kayak on Elkhorn Slough, which is a marine sanctuary for sea otters, and there was hundreds of them, and babies and mamas, and they were swimming around my kayak, and oh yeah, I got my hot toddy, Deirdre, thank you. It's just nope, Angie, no bad night. It's changed around. You came and you were here for a little bit, which made a wonderful thing for me. You know, it's a big blessing that each of you come to this. So, as Gloria says, and this is why I'm happy that this is meant to be uplifting. I don't want it to be anytime you feel it's an obligation. I just want you to enjoy it and come because it does something for you, and because you come, it does something for me. Just have all you guys here and to listen. You couldn't unwind, Joanne, 3 a.m.? Oh my gosh. Oh, not good. Not good. Hi, Kevin. Oh my gosh. You guys, this is another one of my streamer friends, Kevin Cox. We were on, he is, does live streaming, and Kevin, I don't know, I missed looking back at the, because I was reading, so I don't know when you stopped in, but so thank you all for being here for episode 60 of Keeping It Real, how it's morphed from starting with learning eCam and sharing my photographs to sharing stories and pictures, and now celebrating art and the art of the storytelling, the art of the story, the art in the story in picture books, and giving us a chance to take a look at some of these authors and illustrators that I have known or met over the years and what I know about them and the inside stories around them, and even just how they work and exploring that. And it still gives me some inspiration and lets me pull my photographs into the openings. I don't know if I can do this without it going off. If it will just... goofing around. That's why I should have done that thumbnail last night, right after this, because I wouldn't have given myself that much time. Instead, I waited till today, and I took all day playing with it. Oh, well, it was very fun and very creative, and that's one of the things I need to do for myself, for my own creativity. Yes, storytelling and reading this is very fun, but it's not my photography. It's not that part of me where I'm building those things. So that's kind of what I have a good time doing. So I take a lot of pride in those opening things. So thank you for putting up with them. Best movie ever. Yes. He's talking about Neverending Story. Oh, Angie, you love it. You would love it. Dragons, a white dragon, no less. A luck dragon. All kinds of wonderful things. Thanks, Kevin, can draw on 60 streams. I know. It's been crazy. Angie's been here for, I think, almost every one of them. So has Gloria. Donna's been a bunch. I know Deidre's been coming to a bunch, and Joanne has. Janice was listening. She had friends come over, so they were going to be listening. So I am going to say goodnight because it's getting late and you guys want to go, and I'm babbling. I'm just been so excited. So, I want to say thank you. And from the bottom of my heart, in great sincerity, this has just been special, as are you. So I leave you with this. Keep looking for the beauty hidden in plain sight. It's all around you. And if you have even the little bit of a hard time finding it, go look in the mirror, because it's looking right back at you. See you soon.